Well, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the Atlantic Council. My name is Fred Hoff, and as of this morning, for better or worse, I'm the director of the Rafiq Hariri Center for the Middle East. For the past 3.5 years, I've been here at the Council focusing mainly on Syria and related issues, Syria being, of course, the quintessential problem from hell in the 21st century. For the previous 3.5 years, I served in the United States Department of State as a political appointee, first as a deputy to Special Envoy for Middle East Peace, George Mitchell, where my duties focused on trying to bring about a Syria-Israel Treaty of Peace, and second, as an advisor to Secretary of State Hillary Clinton on political transition in Syria. And I'll leave it to you all to be the judges of how successful I was in both of those endeavors. But in both of these missions, Turkey loomed very large. Ankara had mediated between Israel and Syria in 2008. So when I picked up my own mediation effort as a deputy to George Mitchell, the Turkish briefings on what had transpired previously helped enormously in shaping my own efforts. And Turkey obviously had a lot at stake when the wheels began to come off in Syria in March 2011. I can remember a senior Turkish diplomat telling me in the autumn of 2011 that if the number of Syrian refugees in Turkey grew to 25,000, that Turkey would have to seriously consider establishing a safe zone on Syrian territory. 25,000. The number of Syrians in Turkey now is something on the order of 2.7 million. Today, we are unveiling an issue brief, Turkey's Syria Predicament, that gets at the heart of Turkey and Syria. My colleagues, Faisal Itani and Aaron Stein, have, I think, produced the definitive answers to questions that have bedeviled analysts for the past 5 years. What is it Turkey wants out of the Syria crisis? What has it been doing to try to get what it wants? What is the report card to date? And what options are open to our NATO ally going forward? We're very honored today to have an extraordinarily brilliant journalist, Joyce Karam, to moderate a discussion with Aaron and Faisal. Joyce is the Washington Bureau Chief of Al Arabiya and a columnist with Al Hayat. We're very grateful to have her time and expertise to help us unveil this excellent piece of scholarship and political analysis. Again, a warm welcome to the Atlantic Council, to the Rafiq Hariri Center for the Middle East, and Joyce, over to you.
The ambassador on his new position as the director of the Rafiq Hariri Center. I think it's very promising for the center and for the region, given his experience from Lebanon to Syria and his vast knowledge on the current issues in the Middle East. So. Well, and thanks also for escaping our Washington's predicament with the weather to discuss Turkey's predicament in Syria. I'm not sure which is worse these days. Turkey essentially has gone from aspiring to have a zero problem policy in Syria to having today infinite problems in the country. As we speak, I mean, this discussion cannot be more timely. A lot has been happening in Turkey. The resignation of the Prime Minister Davud Oglu, a heating border with Syria, an increased ISIS presence, and a different power struggle in the country itself. And for that, I'm you know, happy to be joined with two of maybe the nerdiest and the most attentive to details and the nitty-gritty details here in Turkey's and Syria's politics, Aaron Stein and Faisal Aytani. So we're going to do this in an unconventional way. There won't be opening statements. We're going to just, I'm going to start hammering them with questions for to get the discussion going. And then later we're going to turn to you and get your take on this. So I'm going to start with Aaron. You know, to recap all of this, what do you make of the recent developments with Turkey internally and on the border with Syria?
Sure. And thanks, everybody, for coming, and thanks, Fred, for the nice introduction. Certainly, Turkey's been very busy recently, and it keeps me very busy. I think the good way to describe my job every day is to be a nerd of Turkish politics. And just a brief recap of what's going on is that you have a time in Turkey where within the ruling party, the Justice and Development Party, there is, from the top down, a new consensus on the need to change the constitution. And that need to change the constitution would come with it a change in the government structure inside Turkey from what is primarily a parliamentary system to a very uniquely Turkish-style presidency. You know, there's talk that it's compared to French, it's compared to the United States. In what we've seen about what the document looks like, it's uniquely Turkish in the way it would look. And in that, you have moves amongst the ruling party to prepare for that, culminating with the recent resignation of the Prime Minister Ahmet Davutoğlu, and then the scheduling of a party congress on May 22nd to select a new prime minister. And that really is what we are going forward with Syria being, I would say, issue 1B inside Turkey, with the domestic issue being 1A. And that is, how does President Erdogan either get the votes inside parliament to pass his preferred constitution, or how do they maneuver either by holding early elections to make this happen? And so just to go forward about some of the scenarios that are in play is that the ruling Justice and Development Party in November, last November, lost its parliamentary majority. Excuse me, last June, lost its parliamentary majority. There were early elections scheduled after the failure to bring together a coalition that reinstalled the AK Party as a parliamentary majority, 370 seats in the parliament. And now moving forward, they need to pick up either 13 opposition seats to pass out their draft document of a constitution or hold early elections. And this is really where the state of play is. And so with changing the prime minister was sort of the first step, I would say, in the beginning of what I would think is a summer-long campaign to begin to do this, to begin to build support amongst the population for either a narrow change to the constitution to make the president able to be partisan and remain a member of his party, or for a larger scale change, I would say, sometime next year.
Has Erdogan overreached?
I don't think he's overreached. I mean, I think what he is doing is putting in place, or at least implementing a plan that he has had, you know, in place since around 2010, which is the need to change again to the presidential system for a number of internal reasons inside Turkey. And, you know, I would say there'll be a lot of focus on who the next prime minister will be. It's actually not all that important, you know, by the own admission of people within the ruling AK Party. They will be sort of subservient to the president as we move forward. And so Erdogan will be sort of more outright, you know, the leader of Turkey, if he wasn't already. And you will have, you know, again, a real intense focus, I would believe, of, you know, campaign rallies, so to speak, beginning, well, they've already begun, but really ramping up over the summer about building public support for the need to change the Constitution.
Okay. Faisal, at the outset of, let me call it a fascinating report you guys have done on Turkey, you mentioned that Turkey today is the regional party most responsible for the emergence of a serious rebellion in Syria. What do you exactly mean by that? Can you contrast for me? You know, we know the rebellion in Syria has many supporters. How is Turkey's role different? And we hear a lot in this town that, Turkey maybe supported Nusra. Maybe Turkey had ties to ISIS. Can you, how credible are these claims, and where is Turkey today?
Okay, I'll tackle the first question first. I think their responsibility and agency in the creation of an insurgency in Syria comes from two factors. Firstly is the geography of it. The real serious regional supporters of the insurgency, if you count them, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Turkey, Jordan played mostly a passive role, Lebanon certainly doesn't count. They, with the exception of Turkey, don't have a border with Syria. So they had a much sort of shallower type of interaction with the insurgency. The Turks thought more long-term about what exactly the political order that would emerge in northern Syria or Syria in general would look like when Assad inevitably fell. I guess that was the initial assumption. And as a result, they were able to establish supply lines, ideological ties, personal links to many of the important Arab and Turkmen insurgent groups in northern Syria. And I think they were simply more invested in the outcome as well. I mean, for example, the Gulf states, really what was at stake was Iran's geopolitical position in Syria. I mean, there were other secondary concerns. I don't think they were very heavily political or ideological. And in any case, their appetite and threshold for taking risks and doing things that may have negative long-term consequences in Syria was a lot higher for the states that didn't have to share a border with the country, frankly. So the Turks were both more constrained and had more opportunities to shape the insurgency in more profound ways. To answer your second question about Nusra and ISIS, look, I mean, in my research, I've never come across any evidence that Turkey as a state supported ISIS. The relation with Jabhat al-Nusra is a little bit more ambiguous because Jabhat al-Nusra is part of a broader Syrian insurgency. I mean, at least operationally speaking, maybe ideologically they're distinct, but they fight alongside many of the insurgent groups. They're part of Jaish al-Fatah, an operations room that Turkey has been heavily involved with through Ahrar al-Sham. So in a sense, it's very difficult to support key parts of the insurgency without, at least in an ancillary way, benefiting Jabhat al-Nusra. And I think the entire attitude to Jabhat al-Nusra from the start was they have some utility against the Assad regime. The price of confronting them at this present moment is probably too high given that there are other priorities. And in any case, eventually they can be folded into the rest of the insurgency and brought in line with the more moderate agenda of the Salafi groups. So,
are you saying that Nusra is one of, or the strongest group in the north? And you know, this theory that Nusra maybe will abandon Al-Qaeda, we've heard it recurring in Washington, D.C., but you know, when the Riyadh meeting happened, Jolani held a press conference in Syria and rejected it. There was even, I don't know if you saw it, by our colleague Charles Lister, that al-Nusra might declare al-Qaeda emirate in the north. I mean, did they underestimate Jabhat al-Nusra?
I think so. I mean, I don't know if it's so much about underestimating their capabilities, but I think Turkey may have underestimated the negative effect it would have on the rest of the insurgency, both in terms of the other rival insurgent groups in Syria and the risk that Nusra posed to them, as well as the sort of international baggage that brought the insurgency, the association with Jabhat al-Nusra. I don't think they're the strongest group in the north, and I don't think they're stronger than a coalition of their rivals, but in a place like Idlib, it becomes impossible to operate without at least their passivity or tolerance. Will they break from Al-Qaeda? I mean, I have no illusions about their ideological orientation, nor do I think that there's any room here for them to go and become part of the mainstream insurgency. They've had plenty of opportunities to do that, and it would have been to their military benefit to do it. They don't want to do it. And therefore, I think, no, I don't think it's going to happen.
And for those watching the webcast or here, I forgot to mention the hashtag. It's hashtag AC, Turkey, Syria. You know, reading the report, I had flashes from reporting on, you know, the Bush policy in Iraq, almost what Bob Woodward said later. I mean, you say that early on, Turkey's support for the rebellion was in part that Ankara feared the Syrian regime's collapse would drive thousands of refugees and allow the PYD to take advantage. Today, you have almost 1.9 million Syrian refugees in Turkey. What Turkey feared is today the reality. So what went wrong? And has Turkey's approach to the PYD changed throughout the conflict, Aaron?
I'll take that in a few parts. I mean, I think it's important to put yourself back in Ankara, you know, in the summer of 2011, when you were looking at the uprisings in the region coming forward. You had an actually cautious Turkish approach to many of the Arab Spring countries, and Syria was no different. There was robust ties with the Assad regime. Before that, you had the signing of a free trade agreement, a visa liberalization agreement, and you had a Syria that really was the centerpiece of the changing dynamics within Turkish foreign policy, making 2002 up until 2011. And you have to again take yourself back, again, I would say, to the 80s and 90s, and the role that Syria played in harboring the PKK, which is exactly the same as the YPG, PYD. There is nothing, there's hardly any difference between those two groups. And so the changes that came in Syria, I would say, after the capture of the PKK's leader, Abdullah Öcalan, in 1998, deprived the PKK of strategic depth along Turkey's largest land border. And at that time within Turkey, you had the idea that you could militarily defeat them because their leader had been taken off the battlefield, so to speak. So fast forward to 2011, and you have Turkish calculations. A, you have the prospect of wide-scale instability inside Syria forcing refugees to your border. There's a long history of refugee problems inside Turkey, from Iraq, from Bulgaria at the collapse of the Soviet Union. And then on top of that, the most organized and powerful group along that border was the PYD. And so, you know, this began either you keep Assad in power or you force his departure, but his replacement was somebody that was palatable with minimal reforms to the way the state was structured. Or if you decide to break from him, you need to quickly deal with this. Yeah. And that begins the impetus for the safe zone, you know, right at the outset of Turkey's breaking with the Syrian regime. The idea became set up a safe zone similar to that of Operation Southern Watch, or the northern component, Operation Provide Comfort. House the fleeing refugees there. Allow this nascent Syrian insurgency to begin to form inside Turkey, but also inside Syria. Quickly topple Bashar, and then you can go back to business as usual with a new government in place. And so that was the impetus, or the start of the way in which I would say Turkey conceptualized the Syria problem. The ancillary problems with Nusra came almost immediately thereafter, and I would say, did they underestimate them, to go back to your original question? Absolutely, I think everybody did. You know, looking back at the way the conflict has evolved, you know, Nusra begins to show up on the scene almost immediately. And they begin to embed themselves inside the Syrian opposition. And so without, you know, and as that grew, I'd say it's really metastasized to where it's a very large problem now that nobody can really get around in terms of how you conceptualize Syria policy. And then, you know, and
so
again,
how much of a threat is the PYD today to Turkey? I mean, what key challenges?
Yeah, came exactly. So just to go back to that point, Turkey's policy on the PYD has absolutely changed as the conflict has moved forward. There was, as the PYD consolidated its control along the border in July 2012, the Turkish government looked at the landscape and began to actually engage with the PYD. Salih Muslim, sort of de facto foreign minister, has been in Turkey 3 times that we know of, also met with Turkish officials inside of European countries, I think Rome being the one that's been reported in the press. In addition, concurrently, the government began to restart peace talks with the PKK. And so between 2012 and 2015, you had a ceasefire inside Turkey, very few deaths, and you had Saudi Muslim shuttling back and forth into Ankara. What Ankara wanted of the PYD was not to consolidate its political control inside Syria and to join with the Syrian opposition and fight the Syrian regime. Now, some of that was a poison pill on the Turkish side, but so that's where you begin to have the problems between the PYD and the insurgency writ large over another ancillary issues like other groups inside the insurgency, Nusra, Ahrar, and Ahrar being a very close ally of Turkey.
You can't look at this in absence also of U.S. policy in Syria. I think Ambassador Hoaf was in the thick of it, was maybe in the room when they were discussing if they were going to call on Assad to step down or not. And that came in August 2011, 3 months before actually regional leaders, including Prime Minister Erdogan then, called on Assad to leave power. I know from my reporting that the U.S., after calling on Assad to step down, it went and pressured regional countries to do the same. Yet, and I think that caught my attention in the report, Faisal, that Obama's statement calling on Assad to step down was more likely a statement of preference, not of policy. Were the Turks wrong to, trust Obama's direction on this? And 5 years later, where do U.S.-Turkish interests meet or clash on Syria?
Yeah, in retrospect, I am pretty confident that was the case with respect to preference versus policy. But I have to admit, watching U.S. policy the first couple of years in Syria, what really wasn't always clear exactly what was going on, what the limits of U.S. action were, what the parameters were, what the U.S. priorities were. That became clearer as we went on. But by then, mistakes had been made, or if you don't want to get judgmental, policies had been implemented on the U.S. side that made things much more complicated for Turkey. For example, we haven't talked yet about U.S. policy, but the backdrop for all this is a U.S. policy of relative disengagement from the issue of the regime, Assad, the insurgency, a very narrow focus on ISIS, and through that narrow focus on ISIS, and a strategic alliance with the PYD. And you can see why these are all problematic for Turkey. So all these decisions about the insurgency, about Nusra, about the other groups, they can only make sense through this light. But your second question was about where do the convergent diverge? As it turns out, there isn't much overlap. I suppose that since mid-2015, we can see now a clearer overlap on the issue of ISIS, at least as defined by the need to defeat this group militarily. Yeah. But of course, again, taking this issue in isolation is problematic. That issue is related to the trajectory of the civil war, to the role of the Kurds, to the shape of the priorities and capability of the insurgency, et cetera, et cetera. So many other factors over which the United States and Turkey will frankly completely diverge. PYD's a rival for one, a strategic ally for the other. ISIS is the only priority for one and one of many priorities for the other. Assad is tertiary interest for one and a primary interest of the other. So I think there's much less in common than one would think.
Do you see that changing in the next administration, assuming either Secretary Clinton or Senator Sanders or Mr. Trump is the next president?
Speaking about Mr. Trump's policy on Syria, I've yet to really figure it out. Presuming that Secretary Clinton, I think you'll see a larger convergence. Again, taking yourself back to the original conceptualization of Turkish policy on Syria, there was an expectation of greater American involvement inside Syria from the Turkish side. You saw it play out in Turkish domestic politics. You had then Prime Minister Erdogan saying very publicly in speeches on the campaign trail that Obama's hands would be freer after the November 2012 election in our own country, and so that we can expect more from the United States once we are moving on. And I think that was backed up, and you hear this from Turkish officials as well, by mixed messages coming from our own administration in envoys sent to Ankara, one of them being Secretary Clinton at the time. As you move forward, I think Ankara, there is an expectation and there more of a convergence about what Faisal said, the need now to militarily defeat ISIS sort of within the focus of the campaign, because it's become such a threat to Turkey, the first being the start of a wave of suicide bombings inside Turkey, largely carried out by Turkish citizens who had joined ISIS. And then since, I'd say this, the new year, near daily rocket fire on the city of Kilis, killing, I believe, up to 21 people at the last count, but also really just bringing this to a standstill life inside of a border city that, A, is, inhabited obviously by Turkish citizens, but also by a large number of Syrian refugees. And so moving forward, I think it depends on what policy, presuming Secretary Clinton wins the election, begins to implement. If she moves forward on Turkey's preferred policy of a no-fly zone, I definitely think you'll see a lot of enthusiasm from Ankara and a willingness to participate. But if we continue with the status quo, I still think see a lot of problems. The tactical divergence, as Faisal talked about, obviously, it's like an ocean, and then the iceberg comes out of it. At the tip of it that you see is the Kurdish issue. But underneath all of it is really where the root of the divergences lie, and it's about strategy, about how to defeat ISIS and deal with Syria. It's not simply airstrikes and use the Kurds as a ground force. The Turks can actually live with some of that as long as it stays in a certain part of Syria. Mm. It's that by narrowly focusing on ISIS, you're not getting at the root of the problem. So you'll defeat this group or you'll seriously wound them. Then you'll leave, and then you leave on our longest land border a serious conflict. And then these 2.7 million refugees that are living in our country have nowhere to go.
Yet even, when somebody as war-averse as Chancellor Merkel or others have suggested a very small safe zone, it got blocked by Washington. How much of that is the Obama calculus, and how much of it is actually Russia's intervention in Syria?
Well,
to you both, yeah.
Obviously there was some convergence with the Europeans about the need for a safe zone built around the EU refugee deal that Turkey recently just signed, and now has completely come under strain for a number of reasons. I always read Merkel's comments as using the rules of deconfliction to protect, basically what the Turks have built opposite Azaz, which I believe is a camp for about 80,000 people. But getting to your next question, I think the Russian angle is largely overlooked in this country about how the Russian angle has directly challenged Turkish interests. I mean, to the point where, the regime managed to win back, territory it had lost. It collapsed sort of the Azaz corridor that connected Turkey with Aleppo, and then concurrent with that, a subset of the YPG, the Syrian Kurds, did absolutely cooperate with Russia to take a little bit of territory out towards the Marmara line. And so that all three of those things together directly challenged Turkish influence. And then when you talk to Turkish officials, there's an eagerness to engage with Washington on this Russia issue. It's how do you deter Russia, protect Turkish interests, protect the Turkish border, beginning with the violations of Turkish airspace by Russian jets, and then how do you actually, Turkey, make the cessation of hostility something that's worth something? How do you build upon that actually to address some elements of Turkish interests?
Faisal,
I'll be brief.
Safe zone.
I think this rejection of the idea of building a safe zone is really premised on rejection of pathways that could escalate American involvement in Syria, whether that means confrontation with the Syrian regime or confrontation with its local proxies or the Iranians, and now Russia. There could have been, until September 30th, a safe zone at any time in northern Syria. And in fact, it would not have been that operationally difficult to do, particularly before the Russian intervention. But there wasn't. Then the Russian intervention happened. And if ever you needed a piece of evidence to support the case for not building something like a safe zone, well, now you have the Russian Air Force there. And building a safe zone there would mean potential confrontation with the Russian military, and we don't need to explain why that would be a bad idea. That's an easier sell than we just don't want to have anything to do with the problem. So I think the Russian intervention made the case easier to make, and I think that's still the case. But I think in general, it was based on a broader U.S. strategy of distancing themselves from potential escalation in Syria.
The council had a poll on Twitter yesterday, and I mean, I checked last night. Not sure if this result changed. What are the options for Turkey going forward in Syria? And I think the small-scale ground intervention won most of the votes. I mean, it's not scientific poll at all. I'm just maybe being Donald Trump for a second, but. When you watch what's happening in what you call in the report the pocket around Turkey, is something like this feasible in Jarablus? And what would it mean for Turkey? What would it backfire inside Turkey?
Yeah, so in the report, we lay out a policy solution to all these problems, which is, on the one hand, you have Kurdish territorial expansion on the border. And on the other, you still have ISIS on Turkey's border, and then you have the United States that's focused on ISIS and clearing the Manbij pocket, basically everything west of the Euphrates up until Azaz, in order to facilitate an offensive to take Raqqa. You can't do one without the other. And so in order to address these a narrow tactical way that the U.S. and Turkey can cooperate on the issue of ISIS in the pocket, we suggested the idea of a limited Turkish ground incursion with American and coalition air support. Now, I know it sounds sort of fantastical, but when we came up with this idea, we didn't just pull it out of thin air. It came from talks both with on the Turkish side in Ankara and running those conversations by some of our American counterparts here in Washington. And there was some sort of consensus that this could work. That Turkish armor or Turkish elements of the Turkish military could then take Jarablus, for example, and it would A, solve Turkey's ISIS problem broadly, in that a lot of people around the world think that Turkey supports ISIS, and so that Turkey would be taking uniform action against the Islamic State. B, it would force ISIS away from one of its key steel crossing points along the Turkish border. It would also prevent the Syrian Kurds from moving across and taking the pocket, and therefore sort of saving U.S.-Turkish relations, but also helping to deal with one of Ankara's strategic priorities, which is to prevent the Kurds from consolidating all control over the entire land border. So that was the way we gave forward. Now, there are a lot of problems with this. A, it risks entering another complicating factor into the Syrian conflict, one, with Russia. Two, what if the regime attacks them? And three, what if the PYD begins to attack them? Because concurrently, you have a very large-scale civil insurgency going on in southeastern Turkey, that is absolutely linked to what's going on inside Syria. Just to give a sense of what that conflict looks like in Turkey, since July, there's been over 400 deaths on the Turkish security side, about 50% of which have been caused by IEDs. There's 500,000-plus Turkish IDPs, in addition to all the Syrians that are inside Turkey. And you have untold numbers of PKK casualties, and then mixed within that, civilians that are also harmed inside this conflict. So, that requires a lot of moving parts in order to make this work. One is that the PYD cannot start taking shots at the Turkish military, obviously. That will ruin the coalition against ISIS. Two, Ankara needs to seriously consider revisiting its own peace talks with the PKK. Mm-hmm. And then three, the United States, because of its involvement with the Syrian Kurds, needs to figure out a way either to play a neutral third party role or to work with all three actors, PYD, PKK, Turkish government, to try and at least facilitate this. And none of this is easy. And all of this requires a lot of diplomatic thinking in addition to sort of the pointy end of the spear military option.
Faisal, we're seeing unfolding now is the battle of Aleppo. How critical is that for Turkey? And you know, we heard the Assad regime say on multiple instances now that it does want to retake the border with Turkey. Is that, do you see this happening in between now and the end of the year, perhaps? I mean, how tedious and how pragmatic is such a military task?
Mm. I'm not going to say it's militarily impossible, but look, to answer your question, Aleppo is very, very important, both symbolically and geostrategically and militarily. It's not that I don't think they can do it, the regime and the Russian Air Force. But I just don't think it would be the best use of their time and resources. I think what makes the most sense for them is to continue with the encirclement of the city and impose a siege, and then move northwest into Idlib, where the rest of the core of the insurgency that's threatening key regime provinces in the northwest is would be a difficult fight. But there are also two major Shia population zones that they will also need to break the siege on that the rebels have imposed. There's other things on the list. Moving north into northern Aleppo province, to totally take that Azaz area, that would internationalize things in a direction that wouldn't be good for them, and it would leave their flank open in Idlib, and it would leave Aleppo City there. So they can't do all these things at the same time. Having said that, if they do subdue Aleppo City and they start breaking the remaining supply lines through Idlib, then yes, that would be the next logical step, if indeed it becomes necessary, because by then you would have, may have had a collapse of an organized insurgent effort in the north.
But, I mean, given the scope of the war and 5 years, you know, back and forth between the regime and the rebels, wouldn't this take, I don't know, months, maybe a whole year for Aleppo? I mean, what's the time frame that you see if...
Yeah, no, I think it would take that long. I think, look, I can only project forward from where we are right now. There's obviously a huge variable here, which is the United States. We don't know what the United States is going to do next year. We don't even know who's going to be president. So I'm going to hold that thing constant. I also don't think we're going to see a very dramatic change in U.S. policy, although I do think it'll be a bit more assertive and aggressive. But projecting forward from where we are now, the balance of power and the capabilities of the parties on the ground, yeah, I think they could do it. And it will take months, yeah, certainly, mm-hmm. and probably up to a year, if not longer. But but we'll be moving in that direction.
You know, but also, I mean, we've seen Iran admit to losing over, there was a report that another general died in Iran, in Aleppo, yesterday. I mean, this is... add to 13 members from the IRGC. How does this complicate things? And you've mentioned the supply lines from Turkey to the rebels. Has the coordination got better in, you know, taking this pen and sending it to Ahrar and making sure it doesn't end up in Nusra's pocket?
Yes, the coordination has gotten better. You know, sorry, I forget your first question, which I wanted to address first.
The
casualties.
Yeah.
Look, they've taken casualties, several dozen, maybe hundreds, low hundreds. Obviously, the regime has taken massive casualties, as has Hezbollah, et cetera. But they can sustain these casualties because they see this as one of the most important front lines in their regional security architecture. If you want to use a more romantic term, it's empire. But what it is this is their western front line, their Levant, and they're going to keep it. You're talking about a capable, sophisticated, disciplined government that has created good proxies on the ground in Syria and done militarily, given the circumstances, relatively well. Now, yes, they were in severe trouble before the Russians came in, but that has been now buttressed at a pretty low price for the Russians. My perception is that the Iranians are on the ascendant in Syria, not in trouble as such. And my conversations with them about this is that they are relatively confident that the system and institutions and military infrastructure they've built in Syria over the past 5 years is sound, and it would survive the expiration or extinction of Bashar al-Assad. Mm. And I think that that's probably true. Doesn't mean it will stay that way. But again, there are variables, and I'm holding them constant.
I mean, logistically speaking, though, for Hezbollah, you know, who's in Lebanon, headquarters are in Lebanon, to be fighting in Aleppo, to which hospitals they're going to, how complicated is this, and do the rebels have advantage because they are closer to the Turkish border?
Yes. Logistically, it's not impossible because the government in Syria still controls half the country, and the Iranians can operate quite freely in that environment, and Lebanon is not far away anyway, even if Aleppo itself is distant. It does create a bit of a morale and motivation problem for the troops, for the fighters in Hezbollah, particularly when they're deployed to very far away places like Aleppo. I mean, Hezbollah are Lebanese fighters, and their Aleppo for them is probably very alien, probably a different place. But now that they've been doing better militarily, I think this morale problem has improved. Can they do it forever? No. But look, I mean, we look at them from the outside, and we project our own expectations of what success and victory would look like. The truth is that they don't see it the way we do. They think that if they can cram the jihadis into Deir ez-Zor and Raqqa and keep them on the defensive, that's fine. They won. I mean, they don't think that they are ever going to solve this problem. Mm-hmm. So for them, they have to manage their interests. And if they can manage them and secure them, they have to stay in that territory so they can deal with it.
How critical do you both see Turkey's support for any political solution? It's a hypothesis emerging from Geneva. We've seen the American position offer more compromises on Assad, and these days I can't tell sometimes if the quote is from Secretary Kerry or Mr. Lavrov. Where would Turkey be in all of this? Can the U.S. and Russia enforce a political agreement if Turkey does not agree to it?
Yeah, I'm going to start with one of the questions. It's about the Nusra Ahrar supply lines in Idlib, and I'll loop back to the. You know, the way Turkey conceptualizes that problem is that, you know, you have Turkish officials who were willing to at least tell me that they went to bat for the United States with Ahrar al-Sham, and they said we were the ones, to use their language, to get them to distance themselves from Jabhat al-Nusra, and then, you know, you turn around and are not able to then give them support. And I think that, you know, it builds upon how they conceptualize, you know, the Nusra problem and then the supply line issue, which is that Nusra is sort of a minor element of what is broadly a nationalist insurgency. Now, don't get me wrong, it's obviously a major player, but how do you deal with the foot soldiers, not the top leadership? Top leadership will have to be killed. But the foot soldiers, how can they be brought back into the broader Syrian insurgency? And in that case, you can use Ahrar al-Sham as a counterweight to them because they're more forward-leaning and have a pretty strong partnership with Turkey. Now, how do they conceptualize that within the cessation of hostilities and the moving forward into how to agree? You have had a move in the Turkish position on how to get to a no Assad policy, how to get to a no Assad end goal, which is that Assad can stay for 6 months, but within that 6 months, he must absolutely have no governing authority, and he must, you know, not be able to stand for re-election again, and he must, you know, have some way out, either through prosecution in the International Criminal Court or, you know, a villa in dacha outside in Moscow or, you know, living somewhere in Oman, for who knows, right? So that is the way that they would, are willing to accept. It becomes, how do you get there? And this gets the cessation of hostilities. Turkey did support the cessation of hostilities because they had no choice. They were losing, and they were losing badly, particularly in Azaz with the Russian intervention. But as you move forward from that, you come back to the same issue. It's how do you empower the rebels to then begin to put meaningful pressure on Assad and the Iranians and Russia to actually abide by those commitments that it's willing to stand. 6 months phase negotiation. And that's where you have the disagreement again with the United States.
But can the US and Russia push a solution if Turkey disagrees to
it? No. So it's the first sentence, I think, in the report, is that Turkey is the most important actor inside Syria. They will be, A, critical for the enforcement of the cessation of hostilities, because they are the supply line. Mm-hmm. They do have agency with a number of rebel groups, not just sort of the ones we've been talking about, but sort of spanning across into more nationalist factions that the U.S. supports as well. And the idea of not a concurrent flare-up between Kurds and Turks, the idea of a Turkish army in Qamishli, for example. And then stuff hardly anybody talks about, which is rebuilding Syria. Turkey will again be the entry point to rebuilding Syria, and I bet you a lot of Turkish firms will be involved as well.
Excellent. And on that note, we're going to turn it over to questions. I think we have 30 minutes, slightly less maybe, to turn. So let's start over here.
Herb Rose, for some period of time, I realized that the situation in Syria, Turkey, and surrounding countries was an extremely complex one. You shed light on more complexities that I never even contemplated. So what I'm wondering is, considering the number of different parties and their interests, and I'm wondering what the likelihood is on a, if not permanent, a longstanding ceasefire in that area being successful, and the parties agreeing to the ceasefire or cessation of hostilities.
Thais.
I think under the current circumstances, the likelihood is next to zero. Not because I think that there can never be a situation in Syria where there could be a ceasefire that stays. It's the geographic reality, the military geography of the country right now is such that there's a big chunk of territory that's either very important to the regime or adjacent to key regime areas that's held by hostile insurgents. Those hostile insurgents still calculate that they have a chance to hold on to that terrain and that things might change when there's a change in U.S. administration here. They cannot surrender because they will probably be killed or wiped out or whatever, at least their major leadership. On the other side of the equation, the regime doesn't have any reason to surrender surrender would mean Assad's being put out of power one way or the other. They don't need to do it. And they have every intention of reestablishing themselves as the sovereign national government of this country. I know that sounds a bit weird, but that is actually how the Ba'ath regime sees it in Syria. So right now I see no space for this to happen. Intermittent ceasefires, et cetera, that's been happening all along the war. And they can happen on a bigger scale if there's robust diplomatic involvement, yeah.
I think you put your finger on the issue, and I don't disagree with anything you said, but let's presume that they can do it, right? Let's say that the cessation of hostilities, it doesn't completely stop everything, but there's a dramatic decrease in the amount of violence like we saw, what was in the end of March or something like that. You then have the problem of concurrent governing structures, which is why I think, again, Turkey is the most important external actor. The PYD operates a governing model that is very difficult to understand, but nevertheless, it's there. Jabhat al-Nusra has a governing model in Idlib. Ahrar al-Sham has a governing model in Idlib. The regime governs in its areas. And then elements of the Syrian sort of moderate opposition have their own councils as well. Those are five different types of governing structures I can just name off the top of my head. Let's just take the most obvious, the PYD, the regime, and then Nusra Ahrar together. PYD and Ahrar's method of doling out justice could not be more different. So how do you reconcile that within a putting a Syria back together again, which I actually don't think Syria will fall apart.
But what, you know, don't think Syria will what?
Fall apart. You know, you talk to Syrians, these are very nationalist people who like, you know, the idea of their country falling apart is sort of anathema to them. But building a successful post-conflict government with all of these very powerful groups is something that either you have to have a very decentralized model, which would anger Turkey, or you have to have, you know, a lot of groups making serious compromises that they haven't shown willing to do yet.
What's the model that Turkey would be okay with?
You know, at the outset of the conflict, it was very stable Damascus, strong central government, again, aimed at preventing this type of emergence of a power out to the provinces for obvious reasons. I think now that the war has moved in the direction that it would, it would be serious territorial integrity. It's a very tough question because it's hard. Serious territorial integrity, and within that context, not allowing the PYD to have sole governance over its areas, and influencing more diverse Kurdish voices in those areas to try and at least, undermine or at least break their consolidation of power, and then bring them at least subservient into some elements in Damascus.
You look at the north, and sorry, I'm taking everyone's time, but I mean, how much you already, as you said, there are, like, you, from Idlib to Damascus, it's almost a different country. I don't think you can go have a glass of beer in Idlib, and I don't think that might change in the near future. So how much of federalism do you see acceptable for Turkey in Syria?
I don't think Turkey, assuming that its interests are addressed, and I think that really begins with Assad, I think Turkey would be willing to show some level of flexibility. Mm-hmm. What I think would inform their thinking is the way that the Iraqi constitution was drawn up, and Turkey's complete opposition to how that process went forward, and some of the ideas of sectarian quotas or something along those lines.
Okay.
Thanks. I'm Kemal Kirishci from Brookings. I'd like to congratulate you for the brief. I haven't read it yet. But it sounds like a great one. Ambassador, congratulations for your new post. On two points, you asked Aaron about what made Turkey change its policy August 2011, Aaron. I'll go along with all you've said, but I think there's another very important factor, and I'd like to hear your responses, is the way in which Turkey's policy towards broader Middle East changed. There's very good academic work that is coming out on the ideological side of Turkish foreign policy. And the wish to work more closely with political Islam as represented by the Muslim Brotherhood, I think we cannot understand what happened there without bringing that parameter into the equation. I'd like to hear your responses. Safe haven. We worked on this a lot as part of our book on consequences of chaos in Syria. We, meaning with Elizabeth Ferris, in principle, we are against the idea of safe haven unless 100% security for the refugees can be guaranteed. You know, there are lots of examples of these things going haywire, including Srebrenica. The good model would have been what you referred to, Aaron, Operation Provide Comfort. I genuinely think that there is a possibility of putting into place a very tiny such safe haven if it is really well negotiated with the Russians as well. Because my sense is that Russians feel the weight of the humanitarian catastrophe there as well, together with the international community. But the problem there is that, again, it's my humble opinion, right from the reference to the 25,000, I think the Turkish side goal, unfortunately, is not the protection of refugees and managing the humanitarian disaster there. The safe haven looks like a possible pocket for continuing the struggle against Assad. And that's why we're dead scared of the humanitarian consequences. I'd like to hear your responses on both points.
Sure. Look, my own perception, I'm not a Turkey expert. I focus on Syria, but from the lens of the insurgency, yes, I would. I mean, I don't know if Turkish foreign policy actually changed in August 2011, but what I do know is that their treatment of and interactions with the insurgency from that point were certainly done through an ideological lens, among other things. I mean, it wasn't the only criterion, but there was also military capability and reliability, personal relationships, etc. And it continues to this day that things are that the entire policy of train and equip, or equip in any case, is filtered through that lens. That if you're not in line with the broader political Islamist agenda, whether moderate or less moderate, then you're shut out, or at least sometimes actively so, sometimes just ignored. With respect to the safe haven idea, yeah, look, I'm going to be completely intellectually honest with you. When I'm speaking about a safe haven in this context, I don't just mean it as a place where refugees won't be killed, to which, at least in principle, I can see the Russians agreeing to that, although I'm not sure. But I certainly recognize that such a thing would be the kernel of a safe place for the opposition to operate, for the military opposition to operate. I don't see how that could be avoided unless what happened was the opposition and the local populations would agree that this would be a place for the local population to go away from. And that would be a good thing for the opposition, because the local population is a major liability for them when it comes to Russian air operations and regime air operations, because they're the ones who get killed. So it would be a bit of a burden off their shoulders, but would some powers want it to be used as a staging ground for carrying out the insurgent effort? If it was big enough, sure, yeah, I agree with you.
Yeah. The first section deals a little bit with the formulation of strategic depth and how that was supposed to leave towards zero problems with neighbors. Again, transport back to August 2011, you had former Prime Minister Davutoğlu, and Hakan Fidan, the current intel chief, shuttling back and forth to Damascus, on a near monthly basis. And one of the final demands that they put forward, sort of in that last meeting in August, was to allow the Syrian Muslim Brotherhood to basically return from exile as one of the concessions that they could put out there. There's absolutely an ideological component to this. And again, at that time in Ankara, the talk was of, it was the Cairo-Ankara axis. With the concurrent events in Egypt, the rise of Mohamed Morsi, and then sort of the success of the AKP in the 2011 elections, was a really consolidation of what people in Turkey were calling the Turkish inspiration. They never used the word model. And so they did view, in my opinion, the Arab uprisings or Arab Spring through that lens. Absolutely, and so Syria fit in that once they broke away from their cautious policy. And so the earliest groups that you can date, at least you could definitively track the arms to, are Muslim Brotherhood-backed groups and what the precursors to what is now Ahrar al-Sham. With that, they also hosted the Syrian National Council, and the Syrian, we didn't really go into this into the paper, but the composition of the big criticism of Turkey at the time from Saudi Arabia and others was that they were backing it out. They were staffing it out with all Brotherhood support, and so it was basically Turkey's and Qatar's guys, that were trying to hijack the revolution at that time, and that actually led to some tensions with the Syrian Kurds as well for a number of reasons. So absolutely, ideological lenses, I think, did tint this, and I also think explain some of the acceptance of Ahrar al-Sham to this day. As for the safe zone issue, I completely agree with you. My concern about the no-fly zone is not that you can't ground Bashar's Air Force in about 15 minutes. It's that the day after, when you have to then start plinking his artillery units, that requires a pretty large intervention, because those artillery units are what would cause the most potential harassment to a safe zone issue. We could certainly do it, but and I think what differs from the model of Operation Provide Comfort is that that was a defeated enemy. You know, so how do you then, it would require a significant escalation on the point of the United States that the president would have to make that we're willing to take on the regime. And to this day, we stay as far away from doing that as possible. So if you were to build up a safe zone, and in the paper, when we talk about this intervention, this potential for an intervention from the Turks, it wouldn't be taking on the Russians. That's for obvious reasons, that's a terrible idea. It's how do you use the rules of deconfliction and negotiation to try and get what you just said, even just a little thumb in there to try and deal with the ISIS problem and perhaps concurrently help with some of the refugee situations.
But I'm going to follow up on the regional question. Following the new Saudi leadership, we've seen multiple visits between Erdogan and King Salman. Is there a Saudi role in mediating with Egypt, perhaps? And has Turkey, is it walking a little bit away from just putting all its eggs in the Muslim Brotherhood basket? And Faisal, how much do you put the opposition, SNC or others, at fault for failing to bring the Kurds under the umbrella?
Flip that, the Kurds. To your first question.
We flipped that.
There's been an absolute warming of ties between Saudi Arabia and Turkey since March 2015. And I would actually say it's more of the Saudis becoming freer and the groups that they're willing to support inside Syria rather than the other way around. Mm. And strangely enough, I think that's actually because of the Ahrar al-Nusra success against some of the Saudi-backed rebels, I think slightly before that. As for mediation between Saudi and the Turks, it's absolutely ongoing. The Saudi foreign minister said it publicly. And you've seen some fruit from that. Erdogan has stopped at his public rallies holding up the Rabia sign, which used to be every single day. And you've seen a return of the Emirati ambassador to Ankara. So I would say we're moving into a new era of Turkish foreign policy, and I call it ring fencing. It's the idea, absolutely, that it's Iraq and Syria, sort of the core, is sort of lost, and so you then have to then build up your buffer around it. And so it's the KRG, it's the Iraqi Kurds, but really the Barzanis. It's the allied groups in Idlib. It's Saudi, and it's managing relations with hostile actors in Egypt and the Emirates rather than seriously going after them.
This is a loaded question to me, but I do blame the Syrian opposition, really derived from the local population in that area, for their hostility towards the PYD in particular. I mean, there may be some racial ethnic tension, but how I've seen it manifested politically in among the Syrian opposition is the PYD. And part of that simply is, to be honest, they have very different agendas. There is a strain of thought in Syrian Arab ideology or conception of the country that is absolutely intolerant of anything resembling ethnic separatism or whatever the PYD want to call it. That's what it is. And autonomy for an ethnicity, particularly the Sunni Arab Syrians, more so than anyone else. But even among the minorities as well. I mean, their political culture is one of where all these things get quashed you know, and they have been by the Ba'ath for 40, 50 years, and people still believe that. They've internalized those ideas. So when you talk to the opposition about the regime, you know, yes, obviously they hate Bashar al-Assad, but at the end of the day, they'll always tell you, look, you know, these people are Syrian. At the end of the day, we have to live together. We'll come to some sort of arrangement. But they don't say that about the PYD. When it comes to the PYD, there is no discussion about this issue of Kurdish political autonomy, no. And the others, I think, and I think the PYD for their part, I don't know them as well as I know the insurgency, but for them, their distrust towards the Arabs, partly historical, partly because the Arabs reject their political project. The main, the ugliest sort of point of contention over the past few years has obviously been the relationship to the regime. And once they took those different positions on the regime, then I think from there on, the relationship was doomed.
But how critical is this Arab component? I mean, one story we were told on background that very early on, 2011, 2012 maybe, few Kurdish, you know, opposition figures, they asked the SNC to drop the word Arab from the Syrian Arab Republic. And that was met by huge objection from the SNC.
Well, it was idiotic, obviously, in retrospect. Would it have avoided the problem? I don't know. But this is, yeah, this sort of, it's a, to use an impolitic word, pigheadedness about the identity of the country was a mistake, where they should have been expanding the tent and the base of the insurgency as much as possible. They took this position. I just think they can't help themselves. And I don't know if, in retrospect, they think it was a mistake or not. But if anything, things are worse now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Kurds are also extremely difficult people to deal with. I mean, just to put it mildly. I mean, they have their own conception of the way the country should be governed. And it's actually, it differs considerably from that of the goals originally espoused by the the Syrian opposition, the Turkey-based sort of Syria opposition. And that's only gotten even more, those schisms have only grown as the conflict has continued. Basically, the Syrians now that are officially representing the insurgency at the talks in Geneva, you know, the fact that you have an Ahrar guy there, the PYD views Ahrar, Nusra, and ISIS as exactly the same thing. For actually a number of relatively easy to understand reasons, because in 2012, all three groups did cooperate against them. And, you know, at that time, Turkey did actually give, you know, Ahrar within that umbrella group support. And so that is the reason why the PYD so adamantly believe that Turkey supports ISIS and then blast it all out on social media. And so you move forward inside of that, you know, it's how do you reconcile these two very powerful actors who have different patrons, one the United States, one being Turkey, for Ahrar, is goes back to that governing question. There are five different governance models, and how do you actually deal with that within something like an SNC, I think was doomed from the beginning.
Faisal.
No,
yeah.
It's okay. He said what I wanted to say.
Do we have any more questions from the audience, or shall I? Oh, we do. Okay, let's go to the lady in the.
Hi, my name is Jennifer Clark, and I work for the Public International Law and Policy Group. My question is, what is your opinion of the current political peace process in Geneva, and particularly the role of the U.S. and Russia in terms of finding a political solution as opposed to a military solution? Do you think a political solution is possible, or does it look like a military solution is what we're going to get? Thank you.
I mean, one of you, Faisal.
I'll give you a very brief answer. I think the U.S. role has been to convene and to pressure the opposition to agree to some of the Russian demands. It's a track that's completely separate from the military reality in the country, and it's not supposed to reflect it anyway. It's supposed to be something to tamp down the violence and get a political process going. I don't think it'll work for reasons I explained, because I don't think the insurgency can afford to agree to it, and I don't think the regime has any reason to agree to it.
So do you see a military, things going for a military solution, to answer her question?
I don't distinguish between a military solution and a diplomatic solution. I think a diplomatic solution arises when the military reality on the ground makes one possible. Military war would not lead to a political outcome, and the diplomatic solution without a supporting military reality is a waste of time.
Okay. Over there.
Good morning, I'm Scott Morgan. Going back to the regional context, one country we haven't heard about is Israel. We've seen Erdogan start some small rapprochement with Israel, and now we're seeing the Russians with a charm offensive towards the Israelis. How do you see that portraying changing the situation on the ground? And the other part is regarding the ceasefire in Aleppo. How is that lasted so far without the involvement of al-Nusra in the talks?
I'll take the Israel. I can't really comment. I've only been to Israel once, and I don't know much about it. In terms of the Israel-Russia dynamic, but in terms of the Turkey-Israel dynamic, I'd say that has been in the works for quite a long time, but for political reasons have been gummed up on both sides. The Netanyahu government, I would say, used this term, despises Prime Minister President Erdogan, and Erdogan, I would say, is not too fond of Netanyahu. But political realities are forcing the two parties back together. Syria being one component, but I would say component number two, and I think the primary driver of this is the idea that you can unlock Eastern Mediterranean natural gas resources, that you can then begin on the Turkish side to diversify away from the heavy reliance on Russia. And I think that this was built out of Ukraine, Crimea, and then really with the Russian intervention inside Syria. Now these projects will not, assuming it all works, it's also dependent on concurrent settlements inside Cyprus, which there is good news if you follow Turkey and Cyprus, but they can easily fall apart. Those talks could easily fall apart. And so that becomes something that you could project maybe 15 years from now, an Israeli pipeline through Turkey and then maybe onto places inside Europe. So there's an idea within Turkey. And I think it goes back to that sort of, I call the ring fencing policy now. It's Israel is something that needs to be engaged with, even if there's antipathy on all sides because of these issues. And also, there is a belief amongst elements of the Turkish, I'd say, decision-making class that unlocking Israel also helps smooth your problems in Washington. So when Erdogan was here, he met with Jewish leaders, or at least members of Jewish, interest groups, civil society groups, to sort of spell out his policy. And inside Turkey, I think he may have already done it, or he's going to do it soon. He will be a witness at a Jewish wedding to sort of prove that he's not, that he's really committed to this, to this process.
Russia, Israel, yeah.
No, I'm going to actually talk about Aleppo and this question about.
I can't talk about Russia.
The Aleppo ceasefire obviously collapsed a couple of weeks ago, and collapsed in part because Jabhat al-Nusra was able to convince some of the other insurgent groups that it wasn't working in their favor because the regime was kept bombing them in and around Aleppo. And I mean, fair enough. I can understand how they pulled that off. What I think is going to happen with Nusra or without Nusra is that this thing is going to be paused and unpaused and paused and unpaused until they encircle the city. And then it will be paused and stay paused. But each time it happens, some progress will be made, some damage will be done, and then John Kerry will jump in and the Russians will talk to him and then it will be tamped down and it will continue. It has to continue. It's not logical for the regime to stop at this point in Aleppo. It doesn't make any sense. So they will do it, but if they have to do it in increments, that's what they'll do.
Very quickly, though, we're going to go here.
Hi, I'm Shabnam from the Syria Justice and Accountability Center. I kind of want to shift focus in my question and turn it to the EU. The EU and Turkey are, you know, in the midst of a deal on the refugee crisis, making a deal on the backs of Syrian refugees. And I think that there is some desire on the part of the EU to try to influence Turkey, at least its internal politics, in a way that would both benefit the EU and you know, try to uphold some of these democratic principles that they espouse. Does the EU still have that type of influence over Turkey? Do you see Turkey being influenced in this regard at all, or is Erdogan too far gone on the EU accession issue to pay any credence to EU demands on you know, the Turkish the Syria refugee issue?
It's a good question. I'm going to take it backwards. First, you know, all sides say that the EU process remains their strategic goal, but I don't believe any side. You know, even if Turkey and the EU were to seriously begin negotiating on the outstanding chapters that are in place now, I mean, serious, I mean, 100% government focus, you could not imagine Turkey and the EU for the next 5 to 7 years. Now, if you're not serious about it, you can drag that out for even longer, maybe going up to 20 years. So bringing in the EU deal, does the EU have leverage inside Turkey? The accession process has become partisan in Turkey. When these EU reports come out, you have the 50% who don't vote for the AKP and who don't like President Erdogan using it to sort of bash the AKP. And then you have on the AKP side the flipping of the narrative. It's, see, the EU, we're doing all of this stuff, we're bending over backwards to meet all the criteria to join, and they still won't let us in, so this is a biased organization. And so that actually, it's like Erdogan wins when he wins and he loses when he loses. You know, and he wins when he loses. You know, there's no bad outcome for him on this particular issue. So I don't think the EU has really any serious, you know, influence in Turkey other than it colors the debate that takes on domestically and then how that filters up into the political process. Now back to this refugee deal. I mean, it was problematic from the start, but, you know, at least they tried to do something, and I know they did build it on the back of Syrian refugees. And so putting aside all moral arguments, it has decreased the number of migrants who are crossing the Aegean Sea. But now we're coming up to it where the EU has to, you know, where the two sides have to really put up, you know, their progress reports. The EU has to be willing to lift visa requirements, and Turkey has to meet 72 benchmarks. They've met 67. They have 5 outstanding. The one being the most controversial is a redrafting of the terrorism law. And Turkey has said, President Erdogan has said, they're not going to do it. The EU minister, you know, sort of the friendly face, has said they're not going to do it. And so you're getting to the point where either Turkey will have to pull the plug on its enforcement of this deal, and then what will the EU do after that? You know, you read that the EU has a plan B, which is to keep these people in the Greek islands. But I don't know how that physically works. And so my estimate, and this is based upon like basically rational choice, is that you can't really pull the plug on this deal, because what are the Turks going to do? Just allow people to get on rafts and start going again? And you'll have the BBC and New York Times and everybody pointing this out. Is that you have to find a way to move forward. And so I think a potential compromise that you hear floated around is that you don't completely lift the visa restrictions, but you get like, Turks get like 30 days in like the European Union, something like that. You know, so there is a pathway forward, you know, but it's, you know, it's looking pretty dicey at the moment.
Well, I think we're out of time. I can go on for days on this issue, but I know you have things to do. Thank you so much, Aaron and Faisal. And have a great day, everyone.
Thank you.
And check out the report.